Hi, welcome to the second week of the data engineering course. I'm gonna start right away and with a small recap of last week. So let me share these slides. Does everyone see the slides? Okay. So, okay. Let's start with a small recap. So data models, we saw three types of data models, types of ways to structure the data. So the first model is the relational model. So there the data consists of tables with rows. So each table has a number of columns and all the rows in that table have the same set of columns. An advantage of the relational model is that it can be checked with a schema. So for example, if we have a table of users and each user has a first name, a last name, and a date of birth or something like that, we can check with the schema that the first column is a string, the second one also, and the third column is a date time or something like that. The relational model allows you to make flexible queries, so we can query or retrieve information from a single table, or we can join several tables do queries on top of multiple tables. So a table can be stored in a comma-separated file, or usually for large data sets, we store tables in a relational database. It's called an SQL or Structured Query Language database, because that's the query language you use with a relational model. The second type of model we saw was a document-oriented model. So here we have a collection of documents, and each document is a tree-like has a tree-like structure. And so usually we have a kind of database, and each document has a unique ID. So the advantage of documents for storage is that it's a more flexible schema. You can add new properties. And like in the relational model, you have a fixed number of columns for each row. In a document-oriented model, that's not the case. So a lot of flexibility. A disadvantage is that it's more difficult to combine data if it's stored in several documents. So that's a disadvantage. And another advantage is that all data is grouped in one document. So for example, if I have a document about a user on LinkedIn, I can store all the primitive attributes of the user, like the first name, last name, but I can also have a link to all the previous jobs, all the previous degrees, and have that in a nested tree. A document can be stored in JSON or using XML. And we can also store a set of documents in a document database. And that's typically referred to as a NoSQL type of database. And then finally, the third type of model was a graph-oriented model. So here we have more individual, nodes. So nodes and edges. So a node represents a single entity, like a single user. And an edge is a relation between two nodes. So for example, I can have a node user Len with some properties, first name, last name, and maybe that's linked to another user node with an edge like is a friend of something like that. And then the edge can also have properties. An advantage of graph-oriented models is that they have a flexible structure. Oh, sorry, the phone is going. Just going to let it ring. It has a flexible structure. The graph-oriented model is a natural model if you have variable length joins. So, for example, you can have a graph-oriented model with all the cities and all the roads, and then you can compute the shortest path between two cities. So you go from one edge to another edge to another edge until you find a connection. Or also in a social network, the friends of the friends of the friends. That's another example of a variable length join. And if you use a graph-oriented model, it's typically stored in a graph database. So that's a small recap on data models. So we saw a couple of file formats, so comma-separated file. Very easy, you just have your tables. The first line is typically the header, so the labels of each column. And then you have your data separated by a comma or a semicolon or something like that. Typically, you have links between the tables. So for example, in this example, you see that enrollment number refers to another file, which has the name and the last name of all the students. And naturally, in this case, it's split it into two separate files. You could also have one file where you just include name and last name together with enrollment, grade, course, subject, and time. So that you could also do. Sometimes that's called denormalizing data. And the advantage of denormalizing data is that you have all data in one file or one table, which is useful for queries. A disadvantage is that you have some duplication, like Anne van Damme and Jos van Meulen. If you just include it in the second table, you copy those values. So it requires more storage. And so those are two options there. And then on the right, we see the same data, but represented as JSON. So in JSON, we would typically store all information about one user in one document. So here we again have Jos van Meulen, but we include the grades, the enrollment number, the grades for his exam and his project into one file. And then we have XML. So XML is basically another format, but it has the same nested structure as JSON. So the only difference is we use tags. So we have the student tag, which is closed again on the last line, and then we have first name, last name, and so on. And we can nest the tags. So within grades, you have two items, and the first item we see the results for his exam, and the second item for his projects. So those were the file formats in text, and we also have two binary formats we saw last week. So protocol buffers support binary encoding, so that means less storage, also a little bit faster to read and write. And with protocol buffers, you typically define a schema. So you say, is there a library that converts JSON to CSV? Yes, so in Python, it's easy to, for example, load a file in JSON. And then you can loop over over the tree or something and save it to CSV. Also, if you load a CSV file with Pandas, you can also create a dictionary for each row. But you have to be careful, because JSON follows the document-oriented model, so you have a tree. So if you want to convert to a relational model, then you have to split it into tables in some way. And that's you cannot do that automatically. You really have to program that. So it's not like you can, I think from going from CSV to JSON and JSON to CSV is like transferring between the relational model and document-oriented model. So that's some manual programming. Okay, so for the protocol buffers, you write a schema. You say a user, for example, consists of a first name, that's a string, last name, a string, and then the age, it's a 32-bit integer. You specify that, and then you can compile that schema, and you have a library where you can read and write your own binary files. A patch parquet is another format. It's also based on binary encoding, but there the data is stored in column-oriented formats. So we take each column separately, and we store it separately, which allows for better compression. Okay, and then we saw the lab session. So in the lab sessions, we practiced on basics of Python, how to present data in lists and dictionaries, reading a JSON file, and also the pandas library, so for reading a CSV, for displaying the data frame, filtering the data frame on some columns, and grouping a column, and then aggregating based on a column. And like you can group on the master degree of the students, and then you can count the number of students in each master degree, and then you have a new data frame in that way. Are there any more questions about the first week? Was it all clear? Also the lab sessions, was that not too hard or too easy? Any feedback on that? No? Okay, then I'm going to continue. All clear? Great. I'm gonna stop sharing now and stop recording, and then I'm gonna continue with the first presentation.